got something a little bit different today. But for the last few months, we've been running a series on the life of a disciple. Who knows what a disciple is? Follower of Jesus. One who is disciplined. One who wants to follow him so that they can become more like him. Amen? We need to do things the way Jesus did. And several weeks ago, Bernie spoke on biblical finances. And Will, if I could have that slide up, please. Bernie spoke on biblical finances, and if you didn't get to hear the message, I would encourage you to go to our YouTube channel and download that message, listen to it, really catch up on what Bernie was sharing, because it's such an important part of our lives. Our finances make up so much of our life. And finances are something people don't like to hear much about, because that's my money, I've worked hard for that, and I know people that as you talk about tithing, they say, but that's my money. I worked for that. I earned that money. I have the right to make the decision around that. But God actually has a plan and a purpose for every part of our lives. And so I just want to read the verse that Bernie brought up, 2 Timothy 3, 15 to 17 from the Living Bible. You know how when you were a small child, you were taught the Holy Scriptures, and it is these that make you wise to accept God's salvation by trusting in Christ Jesus. The whole Bible was given to us by inspiration from God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It straightens us out and helps us to do what is right. It is God's way of making us well prepared at every point, fully equipped to do good for everyone. So how many people would say that prayer is important? Most of us. How many people would say that faith is important? And there's so much we see in the Bible on prayer and faith. Amen? We read scripture after scripture after scripture, but there's roughly 500 verses throughout the Bible that talk on prayer and faith. But there's over 2,000 that talk on finances and stewardship. And we need to get hold of the fact that finances are actually an important part of our life, not just physically, but spiritually. And that God actually has a purpose behind our finances. Approximately 40% of Jesus' parables deal with money. And we need to lock into so much of, God, how do my finances align with you? What do you need from my finances in what I do? And being able to surrender your life and your finances to God can be a challenge. People like to hear teaching on all sorts of topics, but finances is one that we often don't want to put into practice. We might say it's too hard. You don't know what my life is. God understands how hard I have it. God understands the struggles that I go through. But one of the things that I was looking at yesterday, John 10:10, the thief does not come except to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And Jesus said, I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. So if the enemy wants to steal from us, why would he not want to steal our finances? Our finances come under the category of one of the things he wants to steal. He is a thief. He is after your money. And I think it's interesting when we talk on finances, people say, but you just want my money. No, God wants your money. He wants your money to be sold to him, as in, I surrender everything to you. I want you to be in control of my finances. I want you to be in control of every part of my life, because the enemy wants to steal and God wants to bless. Amen? So today I've asked a few people to be part of a panel that we're going to talk, and like I said, it's easy for us to say, to hear a message, but to put it into practice is a little bit more difficult. And so today the purpose is to have some people, and you might look at some of these people and go, oh, you're blessed, you're prosperous, you can do anything like this. But every single one of these people on stage have been through struggles of some kind. And so what I want today to be is a time when we're actually... we're going to ask them questions. We're going to allow them time to share some of their story. If you've got questions you'd like to ask, just send a message to me. Actually, I better grab my phone so I get the messages. But send a message to me. We can ask the questions as they come up. But I want people to be able to share, I want these guys to share some of their testimony, some of the things that God has done in their life over time. Thank you. I'll need that. But some of the things God has done. And just because I've got these guys up here, I've got Neville, Jono, Kiri, and Liz coming up. But just because they're up here doesn't mean that you don't have a story. And I'm aware that there's plenty of people in this place that have a testimony of their own. So don't think because you're not up here, you don't have a testimony. But what the purpose of this is to actually hear this stuff that Bernie was talking about, this stuff that the Bible says about finances works. And as we surrender to him, we're going to start seeing God do some incredible things. So like I said, everyone up here has got a story of their own. Jono's our family's kids pastor. He's really had a lot to do with discipleship with kids. Neville's got a background in finances, but he's also been doing missions work for many, many years. And he's seen God do some incredible things. Kiri and Adrian have run a family business. They've been broke once before, really struggled financially, but seen God carry them through that. Seen God do the miraculous in their lives. Liz has been a single parent. Many of you know her story. And so it's every one of us have a different story, a different place we've been in, but everyone has seen God do some incredible things in and through our lives. So Neville, I'm going to start with you. What are some of the financial challenges and considerations you face when embarking on your overseas missions?
Yeah, thanks, Adrian. I guess in those very early days, God got our attention. And we felt him propelling us towards the future that seemed unknown and with a lot of trepidation. And I discovered another world out there. I've grown up in Australia. A lot of us have grown up here in Australia. I know some of you have come from other countries as well, but there's a big world out there. Some of you have seen it, some of you may not have, but it was a real challenge. And working in God's kingdom, I soon found out involved time, energy and money. And that's really, and my faith was challenged as we encountered a lot of things. And going overseas regularly, we knew that there'd be money would be needed, not just for airfares, but you see the needs, you see the massive challenge, how people live and the difference between how we live here in Australia and how many people live around the world. And I've been putting money aside for many years for ministry here and also overseas. And God's always made it enough. In those early days, we made a lot of commitments to our partners overseas. And at times I thought, wow, have I overcommitted myself? Have I opened my mouth too wide and committed too much? And sometimes I'd have sleepless nights thinking, I'm not sure how this is all going to work out. But God always makes it enough. He always comes through. We've always found him true. And just to finish, just on this point, Hudson Taylor said, God's work done God's way will have God's supply. And our prayer has always been, God, I want to do your work your way. Because that way he will bless what we do.
Have you always found it financially easy? Have you always found it financially easy in life? Have things always been almost handed to you on a platter? Have you had to work hard for things, particularly in the area of missions, but just in life in general?
Look, I've been blessed with a good job, and I guess it's the difference between what we think in the natural and what we believe God is calling us to do. And there's a faith element there. There's a stretching. And whilst I think, yeah, I've got money in the bank, God is saying, well, you know, I want you to go here, you know, go to the next level. And I think that's been the challenge for me. I've always been somebody who, I guess, is careful with money. I've budgeted, how you do. But in God, there's another dimension. You know, we often think in the natural, but God is there. He's wanting to see faith. He's wanting to see things that we can't see in the natural. And I think that's the challenge. And over the years, that faith element is, you know, my faith's been challenged, and it's been a journey. And, you know, God has always come through. And so I've found him faithful.
Kiri, before I said you were broke, it's probably the wrong term to use, but you've been through struggles.
I think we've been broke more than once, Andrew, actually.
You've been through some struggles. What are some of the lessons you've learned in that journey when you felt like you were so low that you had to look up to look down?
I think the thing that's interesting, in our business journey, we started off in self-employment in a lease of a business, and that seemed like a really secure thing, to rent an established business that had established customers and things like that. You know, that seems like a really secure thing, because I was always quite fearful and always thought you need to know where your money's coming from. But that business didn't go well for us, and we were broke many times. Many times there wasn't money for anything. But out of that, because we saw God provide, we had people drop food on our doorsteps, we had money in our letterbox. So one time we had someone give us an engine for our van, and we saw God provide so much that I actually learnt that the things of the world that you think you trust in, like a secure lease, a regular paycheck, are actually not what you trust in. You trust in God. And that was probably the biggest thing that time taught me, even though we were very broke very many times and the business did end in basically a financial disaster. I learned to trust God, and it was like from there's nothing that God cannot ask of us, because I know that God will provide every moment when there really is no money.
And Adrian may be better one to talk on this, but I'm sure you understand the heart of it. I'll see whether Kiri can answer it. The concept, and I know Adrian shared it before, but it was a joinery business that you originally had.
Yeah, that's right.
And then God pushed you in to start another joinery business.
Yes.
Your own. Not a lease one.
Yes.
How did you feel when God said, I need you to do something that's failed before?
I felt like God would provide, because we saw him provide when we had nothing. And it was like God would, because our current business, Easy Kit, came out of a prophetic word at a presbytery. And it was like God was saying, you know, this thing that you thought was a failure, we're actually going to turn that round. And you are not a failure. And we had this amazing prophetic word where, I think it was John Jacks, declaring over us that we were not a failure. And so God took that, and it's like took that thing that the enemy wanted to use to destroy us and turned that around. And we knew that God would provide. Whereas if God had given that prophetic word without this failed business, I would have been like, no way can you give up your job and and start a business like this. But because of the journey God had brought us along, I knew God would provide.
So was there, even in that, you had the prophetic word, you've had God say, you're not a failure, and we need to really grab hold of the fact that we're not a failure until we stand before God and he says you're a failure. And he won't do that. because the enemy's going to tell you over and over and over again, you failed, you can't do this, you don't know how to do this, you're doing it wrong. And he just drives that over and over again. And we need to come back to that place where we're saying, God, I will trust you in this.
Yeah.
Was there any fear in that when you sort of said, yes, God, we will?
No, not really. Like, but that doesn't mean that it was always easy. And through the years of the business, there have been times when it's been very difficult. And there's been times when we haven't really been sure if we would continue in business, or if that was the end, if we were not going to be able to get through the global financial crisis, if we were not going to be able to continue in business, if there would not be enough work. But for me, the fear was gone, and I knew that God would provide. I mean, we had to keep coming back to that. We had to keep coming back to the fact that, God, this is actually your business. You have birthed this. You have called us into this. So now we need you to provide. It wasn't easy, you know, it's not just like fun all the time, but we really did have that real solid assurance that God would look after that. And also I had the assurance that if the business did go completely amiss, God would provide something else. Mm. So, you know, still I say it wasn't easy through the way, but in that area I really knew that God would not let us down.
Was there ever any concern that God would ask you to give more than you were capable of?
Well, you know, capable is this really interesting word. It's like you think you're not capable and then God shows you how much he thinks you're capable of. And I sort of almost feel a bit like, it's like, come on, how much can we give? And what will you do, God? Mm. So, yeah, I mean, just really had this huge trust that God would always come through, that he would not ask more than what we could, and that in pushing the boundaries of what we think we could do, he could do more.
Yeah, yeah. Jono, one of the things we've talked over the last few weeks is, Bernie mentioned it in his message, the three jars, the 70, 20, 10, the 70% being to live off, the 20% being savings, the 10% being for tithing. You've taken some of that principle and taught your kids a slightly different version of that, but you've actually taken that role of, I'm the discipler of my kids, I'm going to teach them. What are some of the things that you've sort of experienced, you know, through that, and some of the things that you've actually taught your kids?
I think it's really important that we train up a child in the way they should go. Proverbs 22 says that they will not depart from it. It's a proverb, obviously, not a promise, but I think it's very important from a young age to train kids. And so Elijah was only 5 when we were in hospital with Simeon. So 2 years ago, we were in hospital and we read The Barefoot Investor, which I'd really strongly recommend. It's almost like he's got his wisdom straight from the Bible. Yep. There's a lot of things in there that are good. And he talks about a spend, a save, give jar. And I'd heard that principle before. And so I thought it's really important to train Elijah to do this. And I think at their level, Elijah was 5. He doesn't understand 10%. But I wanted him to get the concept of giving. And already at 5, he did understand that people were poorer than him, that there are people in the world that struggle. And so he would come up to me with some money. And this is a whole 2 years of savings. I'm not talking big amounts of money. I'm not giving him pocket money yet. He doesn't need to. But he would find some money, or Oprah would give him some money. And he would come up to me and he would say, Daddy, is this a big one or a small one? And hold up a $2 coin. And I'd say, that's a big one, Elijah. And he'd go, I'll put that in the give jar. This jar's nearly empty. It's got 20 cents in it now. That's because he only just recently gave a lot more money than in those jars to Neville to take to India. And I think it's really important from a young age. Claire talks about when she was young, and I'm grateful for her heritage, that when she got $1 pocket money, 10% went to the Lord. 10% was at tithe. So she had to give 10 cents to tithe, and that stuck with her. I remember when I was a bit older, a teenager, I would run up to Mum and Dad, who I didn't know weren't that financial at the time, and say, I really, really want this new bodyboard, or I want this new bike. Can I have a bike? Can I have a bike? And they would say, well, you save up half, and we'll help you with the rest. Or you save up the first $100, and we'll help you pay the rest. And it showed me from a young age that things don't come free, and that I can't get what I want straight away, but I have to live within my means. And that's a principle that stayed with me for a very long time. I want my boys to be generous. I want them to be a blessing to many and to be blessed themselves. And I think from a young age we start training. Kids have got their worldview set, as research says, by the age of 7 or 8, depending which bit. So Elijah's there nearly. If I leave this until he's a teenager, I'm too late.
Yep.
So he doesn't get 10%, but he does get some goes to give, some goes to save, and some goes to spend.
It's interesting, that whole thing of train up a child, and when they're older, we've seen it with our kids, is you start teaching them, you know, you've got a job now, you need to start learning how to tithe. They get to a place, but I've worked for that. How does this work? And I remember Bernie shared something with me a number of years ago, and he said, if you will, when you first start work, take a loan for $20,000 and put it straight into your super and never add another cent, you'll retire a millionaire. And I said that to a couple of my kids, and one of them was, but that's $20,000. I could do a lot with $20,000. Like, and the mindset was now. And yet, Adam, who's our third son, he goes, how do I get $20,000? Because he had a mindset of something bigger for when I retire. So some people struggle to look to something deeper, something a lot further away. And it's hard to sacrifice now for something you may not see for 40, 50 years. And Adam was one of the ones we were going to ask to come up and speak today. Because as I shared, I think it was a couple of weeks ago, he started tithing when he first started work. And I'd see in the banking $3 come in, and it was his tithe. And I was so, I guess, proud as a father to see my son putting this principle to action. And now I look at him. He's going to be 22 this year. He's got his own house, just had a baby. He's married. He's got a great job, finished uni. He's in a place where God has blessed him, and he sees that God has blessed him. But I think a lot of that goes back to our childhood. And Jonna was sharing that Claire, as she grew up, and Claire is Neville's daughter, for those who may not know, grew up, you tithe 10%, even if it's a dollar. So Neville, can you share, and this wasn't something we talked about, can you share a bit about the culture of finances within your home? Was there an element you really taught the kids, or do they watch you? Because disciple, like, our kids pick up financial understanding from us. We disciple them whether we like it or not. And that's a really good example of how it has happened.
Yeah, it is important to have those, as Jono said, to have those things grounded from a very early age. And that's something that we did. And as I mentioned before, we put aside money early on for both overseas and locally. And we wanted to teach our children that principle as well, because I believe that the New Testament principle is that we should be cheerful, liberal givers. Mm. And it's so important that is, conveyed, to our children down the line.
Mm-hmm. Liz, there was something you'd shared about there were times when things were really tight within the family, and you've actually included the kids in budgeting within the house. And now there's two thoughts on this. Neither are right, neither are wrong. It just depends on how it all works. There might be an element where you need to ensure that your kids have security, that they know things aren't tight, that mum and dad have got things under control. But there's also times when the kids are going, hey, I want the new shoes, I want the Nikes, I want the new bike, the new skateboard, this. And you're going, I don't even have $10 in the bank. How do I explain this? So how did you engage the kids with your things when things were difficult?
I suppose my approach to parenting has been very much of wanting to raise them. And if we don't have those kind of conversations, how are they going to learn? And so particularly as a single parent household, it became round the table discussions. And so I've always worked with the thing of, if you've got a question to ask, ask it. But we would sit down and talk about finance and about well, we've got this much coming in and we've got this much coming out, and we're going to tithe this much, and how much, would we give away? And then we would pray, and then we would ask God for the things that we needed. And I remember a number of years ago, as Joshua had hit a point of working out his faith of whether or not he was going to walk with God or go out into the world for a bit. And he said to me, Mum, I got to a point where I realised I'd seen God turn up so many times that I couldn't deny that he wasn't true. And it was through those discussions, it was through waiting on God to provide our needs, literally, miraculously at times, that instilled faith into and deposited faith into, well, actually all of them, because I've had a similar conversation with Timothy in the last couple of weeks of just seeing God move miraculously. And so they've learnt tithing is an important part of your financial stewardship, but also they've learnt to trust God. And we've seen that as, as Joshua and Maddie got married sort of a year or so ago, they stepped out in faith on what they felt God was saying, and they watched God turn up in the most profound ways. So it was those sorts of things where I just went, yes, sometimes they have carried a load in a sense, that wasn't theirs to carry, and yet they also will say, but we've seen God turn up in ways that continue to blow my mind.
That's fulfillment of that verse, train up a child in the way he should go, when he's old he'll not depart from it. And so many people go, well, I'll bring my kid to church on Sunday, send him to Sunday school, and that's it. But when we train up a child and they actually get to see God at work in our lives, when they're old, they want to do the same thing. That's literally what the Bible says, that they're going to go, well, why would I do something different? I know how this works. I know how God works. I know God is faithful. I know that when I struggle, I can come to him, and that's the sort of thing that I want to see. And I think that's the difference, is that you didn't just include the kids in the conversation of we don't have the money, but you included them in this is actually God's provision. So they got to see the whole picture, not just part of it. So they learnt security in that process in God rather than in you.
Yeah, and I think that was the thing. I was learning on the hop, and I was trying to teach them, have been trying to teach them, you know, God is the supplier of everything we need. Mm. He is Jehovah Jireh, and that became the foundation to those conversations of God will meet our needs when we need it. And yeah, we have seen time and time again where God has turned up, and it's been amazing.
If you could do this briefly, but you've got a story around New Zealand and God's provision, that your kids saw the evidence of that at one stage. Can you share that briefly?
Yeah, we've got lots of amazing holiday stories, but about 3 years ago, must be 4 years ago. Anyway, my dad was turning 70, and don't tell anyone I said that. I mean, but you know, we at the beginning of the year, we just had this. We wanted to take him back as a family back to New Zealand to his family to celebrate his 70th. Don't look at me, Mum. and I knew God had said we were going. I just knew, and I was like, okay, Lord, so you're going to have to provide the finance for that, and bit by bit, and I remember joking at one point, because I was like, it was getting closer and closer to October, I remember joking about maybe we'll take the bathtub out and put the plug in and we'll paddle over, kind of going, because I knew God was saying we're going, but I didn't know how we were going to get there, and then the money came in for the airfares, and I was like, awesome. And so there was my brother and his three little ones traveling, and his wife, and Mum and Dad were already going, and myself and the four boys. And it was literally 2 weeks before we left. We needed to find accommodation. And I was like sitting one morning saying, Lord, I don't know how this is going to work, but it was starting to be in that place of trusting that God had it, but not stressing about the fact that when was this going to turn up. And I was sitting doing breakfast, it was school holidays, and saying, Lord, you know, I need you to come through on this. And I literally got a phone call within moments, and it was a dear friend who said, hey Liz, I heard it's your birthday next week, and I want to pray for your accommodation while you're in New Zealand. And I was so shocked that I hung up on them. And Timothy and Joshua were in, so they were like, you know, still at home at that point, and they were in the kitchen, and they're like, Mum, what's the matter? And I was sitting there going, and I said, you know, this person had just rung and said that they wanted to pay for their accommodation while we were in New Zealand. And I mean, that was a couple of $1,000. And they were just, you know, gobsmacked as well and everything, and I finally composed myself enough to ring back and say, I'm so sorry, thank you. And then I explained, I'd literally just been sitting with the Lord in conversation, and they said to me, they'd thought about ringing a couple of hours earlier when they'd felt that the Lord had said that to them in their early morning devotion time. And then they thought, no, I'll wait for a couple of hours until later in the morning. That wouldn't have had the same impact had they called a couple of hours earlier, because I hadn't had the conversation with the Lord. And yet he turned up, and God's timing is perfect.
Mm. And the Bible talks about tithing as our the first part. Like the 10% is actually God's. And I know with the Barefoot Investor, when he actually talks about the three jars, he has the breakdown. He doesn't come from a Christian perspective. And I remember looking at that at one stage myself, because I've read the book as well, and I would also highly encourage you look at it. They've also got one for kids, for families in general. So he really goes into detail with helping people manage their finances as well. But the biblical version is that we actually manage our finances under the anointing and leadership of God, that we surrender our finances to him. And so one of the things that I did is I took the 10% out and I said, that's God's. And the money I had left became what I then started saving according to the structure that he had. So it's understanding the point of tithing is the first 10% is God's money, not my money to shuffle how I want. And even as a church, a question came in before, do we tithe as a church? Yes, we do. We invest into missions overseas work, into different areas, and there's more that we could do. There's obviously a whole lot more that we can do as a church. But we believe that the principle of tithing is a biblical principle. And I remember even when I ran my own business, I would tithe the money that came in there. I didn't have a good understanding of it all, and I was probably excessive in the way I did it all. But I said, I just want God to bless my business. Neville, what are some of the things you've experienced through missions, through the giving, the principle there, how that's impacted you in the missions area?
Yeah, I think we all know that we need to be good stewards. Not on?
It's coming.
Coming. And I think, the Bible says if we're faithful in a little, then God will put us over much. And, of course, giving, certainly I'm thinking in the mission context, it's always more than finance. It's our lives. It's our focus. It's our energies. It's our own being. And I know when we set up the Mercy Aid years ago and we opened a bank account, I wanted 100% of all that people gave, I wanted that to go to the field, to go to our partners. And it does. And also, I had this fear of the Lord come upon me. God was saying, this is not your money, this is money that other people have given.
Mm.
You know, make sure you handle this well and make sure you send it on. And we've always maintained 100% of whatever anyone gives will always go to our partners overseas.
So what value do you place on stewardship? It could be emissions, could be our whole lives, but stewardship's a lot bigger than just managing something.
Yeah, no, it's absolutely essential. It goes right to the character of who we are.
Mm.
It goes right to the character of our claim to be followers of Jesus.
Yeah.
And so it's a sudden death thing. It's black and white, you know. We need to be good stewards. And we all know the stories in the Bible about what happened to the unfaithful steward. And of course none of us want to be in that situation.
Yeah.
And so that's so important. And as I said before, you know, the fundamental principle of the New Testament is to be a cheerful, liberal giver. And, you know, I know we talk about 10%, but I think 10% is really the bottom. It's the base.
Yeah.
And I think it goes up from there. And of course, Bernie shared a couple of weeks ago about John Wesley, who set aside 10%, and then, of course, as his income improved, that giving went up and up and up and up.
Mm.
And so I think that's so important. And just one other thing, I think passion has a lot to do with our giving. If we don't have a passion, and particularly for God's kingdom, then it, of course, passion drives everything. And passion will drive giving. It will drive where we put all of our energies into. And so it's like, you know, sometimes we think, oh, I have to do this. I have to give 10%. Well, if we've got passion, it won't be because we have to. It'll be because we want to.
Mm.
And I think that's a really big difference.
And the reality is we give to things that we value, which could be McDonald's. Netflix, and things like that, missions.
Yeah.
Jono, what's some of the advice you would give with some of the pre-marriage counselling you do, particularly in husband and wife, how you manage finances together, how you plan, how you budget? You know, is there anything in particular you might target within that area?
Yeah, it's fun talking about finance with people that are going to get married, because we come from such different perspectives. Something that was said before, or was mentioned before, really burned on me is parents are definitely the most influential people in their children's life.
Yep.
And it was when Liz was talking, I nearly interrupted. And then I see that when I'm grabbing two new young people who are going to get married, and they sit down and they've got such a strong differing opinion because of their parents' upbringing. And from my heart, the cheerful giver is the most important thing as well. But in a marriage context, or in any relationship like that, where your finances are joined, I say communicate, talk about it. And I keep saying communication in marriage is the most important thing. Now, you can do separate bank accounts, you can do joint bank accounts, you can budget really specifically, you can not have a structured budget. Those things pale into insignificance compared to communicating, talking about it with your partner. You may have one that's really strong that they want to tithe and the other one that doesn't. Well, come to an agreement right from the start. I remember when I did pre-marriage counselling with Claire, and we sat in Bernie's office, and Bernie said to us that he made up a rule with Susie, a silly rule I like to call it. He said, we will not spend more than $200 without first getting in contact with our partner. And he says, it doesn't matter what limit you do, doesn't matter what it is, but make a line, communicate about it, and then you won't have arguments later on when you've spent money and the partner thinks you shouldn't have, or whatever it is. So I think that's the biggest thing for us. In one of the books that we read in preparation for pre-marriage counselling, finances was causing the second largest cause of marriage breakup. It's a big thing. So all I say to, well, the main thing I say to people is just keep talking. Talk about it. Work out something. You will have difference in opinion. I love hearing Neville's voice come through when Claire talks about money. It's very clear. And that's cool. But as long as you communicate, as long as you're open, yeah, the other things. The next bit of advice I give people is don't go into debt. Wherever you can, live well within your means. Yes, go into debt to buy a mortgage, to buy a house. In some cases, it might be important for a certain business. But make sure you pay that mortgage off as quickly as you can. Don't go into debt. Don't live beyond your means. Be happy with second-hand, good quality furniture, second-hand, really good quality phone that 2 years ago was, you know, the best phone. But don't go into debt, and pay your mortgage off as quick as you can, because then you're free as a bird to be the cheerful giver that, yep, God wants you to be.
Yeah, it's good. And you talked about, discussing, communicating together, and there'll be disagreements. Liz, there was something that was given to you once, some advice given to you one day when, in your first marriage, your husband didn't want to tithe, and he said, that's my money, you can't touch it. Yet you were given some really good advice to enable you to still tithing. Can you share that?
Yeah, it was actually Inika who used to faithfully meet with me once a week, and we would pray together, and we were talking about tithing one day, and I was like, I don't know how to do that, because just of the circumstances that I was in at that point, that was the situation. And she said, then take the 10% and tithe your house, that which I was given. And so it wasn't the gross amount that was coming in, it was what was put into my hand, and I began to tithe that. And it was at that point that I began to see my shopping bill would suddenly fit in that budget rather than not fitting in that budget. And it was at that point, as a young 21-year-old, I think I was about then, of going, it was seeing regularly the faithfulness of God. It was almost like there was a plug put into that which was leaking or something, and started to just see those things which at that point were just like, oh, this actually works. And there's the scripture that's in Malachi 3 about, you know, bring everything into the storehouse, you know, and God says, test me in that. And so I did, because I like a good challenge. But there's been times in my walk with God, I'm like, God, I'm a tither. I'm stewarding this. And Lord, you said. And it's those moments where God is faithful to his word. He is faithful to his character and who he is. And so it's those moments where, yeah, you know, and it's the same with the kids, you know. It's like when you get your pocket money, bring that before God and tithe that, you know, and be ready to give it away. Because ultimately it might, you might tithe 10%, but if he says give away 50%, it's his. So give it away and watch him provide. Because it's amazing. Sometimes a little bit, you know, hang on to the edge of your seat, but it's amazing to watch and see what God can do and will do when we put our faith and our trust in him.
Neville shared before about, tithing, the 10% is the minimum. You look at the verse in Malachi, it says, you've robbed me in tithes and offerings. And so the mindset, again, is bigger than just the tithe. God wants a whole lot. Have you had times where God has asked you to give all that you had left? And
yes.
What happened as a result?
Look, there's been times, and there's two things that stick out particularly, you know, and Jesus talks about the widow who gave more, you know, she gave than those which were putting in while they were at the synagogue. But there's times where I've felt the Lord say, I want you to give what's in your wallet. And it was my last $10. And being just like, you do realize, don't you, Lord, this is my last $10. But then having to be in that place, and I think, you know, as I was reflecting on it even this morning, going, the thing that I learned over the last 14 or so years is that to not be in a place of fear when it comes to finances. Because the Lord wants us to be always in a position of faith. And so it's been in those moments where I've put my last $10 in, almost like that reaching out and letting go, going, okay, Lord, this is yours. I'm going to give you my everything, literally, financially right now. And at the end of that service, someone walked up to me and they gave me $100. And I've seen it happen, you know, when I put my last $20 in another situation. And I've then been given $200 later on that day. And it's like, what if I just held on to that $10 or that $20? And I would have stressed for the next however many days about how was I going to pay for the groceries or how was I going to put petrol in the car. And yet in that place of letting go and just going, okay, Lord, I'm going to trust you. I watched him provide, and then I didn't have that burden anymore because he provided above and beyond what I'd even given him. And that's the goodness and the faithfulness of God.
Kiri, has your heart ever been tested through giving?
My heart?
Like attitude, your heart, how you've...
I think the thing that I've learned is that the principle of sowing and reaping, that you sow into the kingdom. And I was thinking this week about the verse that talks, where Jesus talks about, you know, giving a cup of cold water to someone. As much as you do it for the least of these, you do it for me. And that's been the challenge sometimes, is that you give, or God tells you to give to somebody, to a specific person, and you give in obedience to God, and they don't seem to really appreciate that, or they don't really seem to value it, or you're not really sure if they used it for the thing that you thought they needed it for. And the challenge that I've sort of come to see is that you do it for Jesus. You give it because he stirs your heart, regardless of whether they appreciate it, regardless of whether they say thank you, regardless whether they knew that you gave it, you have to work on your heart first, because if you give without that heart motivation being right, it's as if you didn't give. It's as if you didn't give it into the kingdom. It's as if you just gave it away, because that's the challenge for me, is that, God, will you provide for me? Yes, I know you'll provide, and so I'm not really counting on if I do that for someone, they'll do it back for me when I'm in need. I'm counting on the fact that God will see it. And so if God tells me to give $100 to a person and they don't really need it or they don't know why, that doesn't really matter as much as the fact that I responded in my heart to what God said. You know, it almost that side of it doesn't matter as much as what's going on in my heart and whether my heart towards God is right in that situation.
Here's one I've just been thinking, Neville. You're one who's very well ordered with finances. You're a planner. You're strategic. Has God ever asked you to do things outside of what you have planned or have thought or have imagined, particularly within missions, but again, our life?
Yeah, no, I recall a time several years back. We're in Burma. We're up in a remote northern town. We'd been there for a conference. I think we're on almost our last day, and our friend Chan said, some Christian friends of his were building a school, and he said, I want you to come out and have a look at it. And so we went out and had a look at it, and it was very, very basic. You know, gravel floors in where the children were sitting, because they hadn't got around to putting concrete down. But they also had a problem with water, and they were really wanting to set up a good water supply for this school. And so I asked Chan, I said, how much money would it be to set this up, you know? And he sort of gave me an indication. And going to Burma, you always need to carry US dollars with you, because that's the main currency. It's not the local currency, but for foreigners, you can't use anything else but US dollars. And so I had some US dollars with me, and anyway, we decided to give it all of the US dollars that we had towards this project. And it's not very often that you've got to make a decision. You know, within maybe, you know, an hour or two, you've got to decide, you know, we'll probably never be back this way again. It's not always easy getting money to them. And we decided on the spot, right, we'll give them all the US dollars we had. This is a great project. This is a great school. And that's what we did.
Mm. Did you see any fruit from that?
Well, the school's going on. And one of the things in missions that we always want to see is that we want to see local people, you know, do their bit. You know, we don't go in there and solve all their problems, you know, financial problems. We want to help them. We want to encourage them. But we also want to see them do their bit. And the following few months, Chan sent us some photos of the development of the school. You know, they're fixing it up, they're improving, they're doing this, they're doing that. And so, yeah, so that was good to see.
I guess one of the areas we can get out of balance is with the principle of sowing and reaping, we think, well, I'm going to give $100 here and God's going to give me $10,000 here. Which would be great, but it doesn't always work that way. As Kiri shared, sometimes you might sow something into one person and then God will provide through it through another person. And that's sort of one of the examples, I guess, of actually, you know, giving in something here and trusting God and actually seeing the fruit actually happening there, that not only have you given to a project, the schools continue on, there's lives being changed every single day. And even while we're sitting here in Australia, that money is still working. There's lives still being touched and changed. And rather than me giving because I want to get something out of this, it's me giving because I want to see the kingdom of God expand. And the principle of giving is actually, it's a heart attitude of surrender to God. He will bless as a result of that. We've seen, heard a number of testimonies. I've seen it with my own life. God has blessed us as a result of our giving, but our attitude shouldn't be, I'll give so I can get, because then the motivation is wrong. This is a question for anyone. Have you ever seen God give outside of how you expected him to, or provide, or, you know, we sort of think, I need this bill paid. Have you seen God do things outside of what you expected?
Well, often in the time when things were difficult for us financially in the business, I would go to the letterbox and there would be an envelope with money in it. Often people would just give us food, and it was, or even like secondhand clothes for the kids. I mean, hand-me-downs are great. You know, it's really amazing. And when, see, this is not quite finances, but it's God's provision. Well, after we had Samuel, you know, that was really not very much fun having Samuel. being pregnant, for anybody that remembers that time when I was so very sick. And after
just to clarify, that wasn't Samuel was the problem.
No,
it was actually
Samuel
the time.
Wasn't the problem. Samuel's amazing. When I'm pregnant, I am very sick. And we were not going to have any more children. And so after as Samuel grew up, I gave away everything. Every baby thing I gave away. And I used to joke and say, God, if you ever do such a miracle that I could be pregnant again, I'm sure you'll provide. And, well, I did get pregnant again. And that was another different story. But God provided for Elise. He provided every bit of baby equipment we needed. And he provided a friend that had a child slightly older than Elise who gave box after box of designer label clothes for Elise. And, you know, that was in our very early business days where we didn't have money to go buying a lot of baby things, but God just faithfully provided all that we needed practically.
Have any of you, and again a question for anyone, ever been able to outgive God?
No.
I've just got to say that, you know, some of you know I've recently written a book going back over the last 30 plus years, and it's interesting to lay down and to see again afresh what God has done in my life, in our life, Deirdre's life as well. But you know, I've come to the conclusion our cups are running over. They are running over, not just materially, financially, but in the rich friendships that we've made. People say they pray for us every day. Our cups are just running over.
We
for years have had a sponsor child, an overseas sponsor child, and you know, we'd give regularly every month, and we'd give money for Christmas gifts, and they would write back, and they would, you know, we'd give $20. And they'd write back and say, and I bought a bike and a watch and a this and a this and a this, because $20 in their country would buy so much. And it's so humbling when, you know, you think you're worried about certain things, and yet the little that you can give can make such a difference in somebody else's life, that it is, like Neville says, so humbling to sort of think our Western priorities sometimes need a bit of a shake. And that, you know, we really can't outgive God here in Australia, because we are so blessed to live in a nation. And, I mean, we are so blessed to live in a church community like this that will help and provide. We're blessed to have friends that will stand beside us and give us a spare room if we were really stuck. Because, you know, we have so much compared to what other places have, that, you know, we should take that challenge. Can we outgive God? Can we give more than God would provide back? Probably not.
And I don't even think it's... I think we forget that it's not even just the third world countries. I had a cousin, some long relative, come from Holland, who was wealthy enough to travel. And he came and stood on my deck of my rundown house that had pink walls and lime green walls and flowery carpet and a falling apart kitchen in our eyes. And he went, "What? Is this yours?" I went, no, the bank owns it. The bank owns it. And he goes, no, but is it yours? And I said, no, it's the bank's. We've just got a loan for it. He goes, yes, but is it in your name? And he was from a very rich country. But compared to how he lived in Holland, we are so wealthy. He was amazed that we had a backyard. He was blown away that our house wasn't co-joined to the house next door. He was just amazed that there was space. And you're right. I hear it again and again. I'm not speaking from someone who's had to do anything risky, because we've been blessed. We've got grandparents that are great. We've got friends and family that keep providing hand-me-downs. You know, AFL jerseys for Elijah and good quality
things.
That's
very important.
We are so blessed, definitely, definitely compared to third world countries.
Yep.
But we are also so blessed compared to first world countries. And we are so blessed as a community compared to other communities. And I think we've got to remember that. To outgive God in our circumstances is just almost a ridiculous concept. Yeah. We should remember to be generous and just be so grateful for what we've got. And I keep thinking back to Philippians 4, where Paul talks about being content in all circumstances.
Yep.
Paul, as Saul, was a very, very, very rich man. But he was also shipwrecked and jailed and beaten and bitten by a snake, and he was content in both. And I think we are in that rich bracket, really.
Yep.
I hope and pray that if it comes to a place where I'm not, that I'm still content like Paul was.
Just talking about being rich, I mean, statistically, all of us in this room would be in the top 5% of the world.
Yep.
Just think of it. We're in the top 5% of the wealthiest people in the world. It's an amazing concept to think about. And when you think of that, you think, wow, there must be a lot of people out there who are struggling.
Yeah,
that's true.
I was actually, I was listening to a TED talk recently, and this guy was sort of sharing that sort of concept of, he said, our life is so blessed, and he'd actually gone to jail for something that that happened. I can't remember the ins and outs of the whole thing, but one of the things he chose was that if I'm going to go to jail, I'm going to make a difference while I'm in jail. And he started teaching the prisoners and actually helped. He was fairly instrumental in the whole culture of the prison turning around and the way that he taught everybody. Not a Christian guy, but he wanted to make a change. And one of the things he said is learning how to compare, or making the mistake, I guess, of comparing, because he said, if you've got a job, you've been working really hard, it's a good job, you've got a good income, but then your boss calls you in and goes, you've been working really hard, I'm going to give you a 10% pay rise. You walk out of there going like, this feels awesome, like I feel so good. And then the woman who works alongside you gets called in the office and she comes back and goes, wow, my boss just gave me a 20% pay rise. Suddenly the 10% doesn't look good anymore. And you're thinking like, what have I done wrong? And the whole attitude changes because of comparison. Beforehand, you were blessed and excited and rejoicing, and then all of a sudden, the comparison to somebody else being better off than you or getting a better blessing than you, the comparison makes us go, oh, I'm such a loser. And we could do so much damage in that. I think it's good for us to realize that we actually live in a fairly, yeah, top 5% of the world. That's a blessing. So because we live in that, rather than comparing ourselves or looking at what we don't have, we need to be putting ourselves in a place, say, well, God, if I don't have any spare money this week, I've tithed, I've done everything left, I've only got $5, then sow that $5. Come to a place where you're saying, God, I want you to be Lord of my finances. I want you to actually teach me, because like Jono said, he's never been in a place where things have been really, really hard. So that's the time to start sowing and putting seed in the ground. So if there are crises in life further down the track, you're going, God, I've been a giver. I've sown. You said you will bless me as a result of this. You said you would provide for my needs. So I can trust you because I know I've been in this place. And that's one of the things I think we need to have that hard attitude that we're giving to God because we know that he is our provider. And I just in conclusion, I was just thinking yesterday, and I shared this earlier, John 10, the thief comes to steal, kill and destroy. He's called the thief. He's not called friend. He's not called challenger. He is, I think Tim Sheets, you might be able to help me with this, so he's the eternal loser, the enemy is called, or the forever loser. I think the Holy Spirit referred to him in a prophetic word. And I thought, we so often look at the enemy as the enemy. We look at him as one who wants to steal, who wants and to have the attitude of his, the forever loser, because we serve the God who is the forever winner. And I looked at this, I thought, if he is a thief, I started listing some of the things that he wants to steal from us. He wants to steal our joy. He wants to steal our faith. He wants to steal your health. He wants to steal your peace, your vision, your victory, your voice, your calling, your destiny, and your identity. His intention is to steal. So why would our finances not be in the list of things he wants to steal? And so rather than saying, well, this is my money, I have to manage my money, hand it over to God and say, God, help me manage this in a way that honors you. And like we said, you can't outgive God. He's not going to ask you to give above and beyond what you've got. Above and beyond. Now, it might be that you can't buy the next sports car you want because God's asked you to give, money to missions or something like that. But it's trusting God with everything you've got. So even the little things, God, I want to trust you. I want to see you. I want to see your kingdom advance. I want to see the things of God just going, just really take off in this place. We're called to be the ecclesia, the called out ones, the chosen ones of God that are living our life to further the kingdom of God. But unfortunately, so often we want to further our own kingdom. And finances is one of the big areas, and I've shared it before. When we work for somebody, we earn an income. We actually exchange part of our life for money. That's why I think money is such a big thing for so many people, because it's actually a part of our life. And it's so connected to absolutely everything we do. Even in missions, even in church work, everything is linked in with finances. And so if we come to a place where we say, God, I'm going to surrender every part of my life to you. I want to see your kingdom advance. I want to see you glorified. And God wants every part of our life, not just some of it. And that can be a challenge when you've got things, you've got the last $10. How do I deal with this? I heard somebody say one day, he went to a meeting and God said, I want you to give $1,000. He goes, but that's all I've got. And God said, that's all I asked for. And just to be in a place where we're trusting God with everything. And if we have to give our last $10, knowing that God actually understands that, he sees that. He's not trying to rob us. He's not trying to rip us off. He actually says, yeah, you're sowing seed for something bigger. Trust me in the process. And it's a big thing. So we'll wrap it up there. Let's put our hands together for these guys. And we'll just close in prayer. Father, we want to thank you for your goodness, for your faithfulness, for your love, for your grace, for your mercy, for your provision. Lord, you've blessed us in so many ways, and it's such a privilege for us to be able to honor you. Lord, we again surrender ourselves to you. We ask that you lead us even within the area of our finances. Help us to be a people that put you first in everything. Lord, stretch us, help us to grow, help us to be a people who see you at work in our lives. Lord, we want to honor you, and we just commit ourselves to you. Thank you for everything you've done for us. Thank you for the message, Lord, the testimonies we've heard today. Lord, let those testimonies really take root. Lord, let us grow in your word. As we read your word, continue to speak to us. Lord, we want to be a people that hear your voice and are led by you. So, Father, we just commit ourselves to you. We commit this day to you, this week to you. Lead us in all we do, and we just praise you and thank you and honor you in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Do it all you can do. With one word, the mountains move.